Our nobility, the very best of what we are capable of as people, is embodied in our intelligence, our curiosity, and our empathy. And the place where these intersect is Antarctica. Human activity in Antarctica was exploding in the 1950s, at a time of great fear and distrust between nations. But instead of letting the Cold War conflict spill over into the Antarctic, the global community changed course and did something extraordinary. These same nations agreed to designate 1957 and 1958 as the first international geophysical year, a global scientific collaboration to investigate Earth's geophysical and meteorological systems. It resulted in the founding of more than 50 research stations in Antarctica and set in place the mechanisms to freely share information and resources across the countries. The Scientific Committee on Antarctic Research, SCARD, was also founded in 1957 to organise and catalyse international scientific collaboration in the Antarctic. SCARD has pioneered the expansion of both Antarctic sciences and the science diplomacy that is the foundation of Antarctic governments. It was understood that we could only succeed in this endeavour together, and the remarkable scientific and political success of this collaboration led directly to the creation of the Antarctic Treaty in 1959, setting aside the entire continent for peace and science.
In realtà sarebbe più corretto dire pace attraverso la scienza, perché la spinta verso l'ignoto e la sete di conoscenza hanno unito le nazioni attorno a un obiettivo comune. Oggi più di 30 gruppi dello SCAR coordinano la ricerca a livello globale e i nostri programmi di ricerca scientifica rispondono a delle domande scientifiche critiche e rappresentano collaborazioni internazionali che coinvolgono molti paesi. Non solo per capire l'Antartide, ma anche per capire come il nostro pianeta sta cambiando e cosa significa per noi.
We're trying to understand how climate change in Antarctica affects the entire ocean, atmosphere and cryosphere now and in the future. I remember the first time I set foot on the Ross Ice Shelf. I was standing on the world's largest ice shelf, roughly the size of France, and it was floating beneath my feet on the world's largest unexplored ocean. I knew right then that we were there to study something important. When that ice shelf melts, large parts of the Antarctic ice sheet behind it will melt, with the potential to reshape the world's shorelines. It hadn't quite yet dawned on me that we were studying the future of humanity. We know that Antarctica is melting. 90% of the glaciers are in rapid retreat on the Antarctic Peninsula, and more than a dozen ice shelves have completely collapsed, causing the glaciers behind them to release ice into the ocean up to 10 times faster. It appears the ice shelves are the handbrake on the ice sheet, holding back vast quantities of land ice from flowing under gravity into the ocean. Once they go, once the ice shelves go, the ice sheet is unleashed and can lead to rapid and potentially unstoppable sea level rise. The continent as a whole is shedding 250 gigatons of ice every year, a six-fold increase since the 1980s, and what is of concern is that rate is continuing to accelerate. This alone is resulting in sea level rise that will change the face of civilization over the next 100 years. And would directly impact more than 1 billion people who live on the world's coastlines. But even these dire signals of impending change may actually be underestimating the real danger. We just don't know where all the thresholds and instabilities in the Antarctic ice sheet are. For instance, the Pine Island glacier is retreating and thinning rapidly, and we believe that this glacier is like a genuine plug blocking the outward flow from the West Antarctic ice sheet. When that glacier disappears, our models suggest it could trigger catastrophic collapse of a large part of the West Antarctic ice sheet, and in a very short time. And this is really why our program is so important. To be forewarned is to be forearmed. Only through science can we even attempt to prepare ourselves for the world that we are heading into.
Pero no son solo los cambios físicos de la Antártida los que tienen implicancias a nivel global. Necesitamos comprender cómo funcionan los ecosistemas antárticos internamente y cómo se relacionan con otros ecosistemas oceánicos y lo que debemos hacer para protegerlos a medida que experimentan rápidos cambios ambientales. En un buen día en la Antártida las aguas literalmente estallan de vida. El océano austral sustenta el ecosistema más rico del mundo si se mide en términos de biomasa, es decir, el peso total de todos los animales que allí viven. El mayor contribuyente es un pequeño crustáceo parecido a un camarón, el krill, la criatura más prolífica del planeta. Cada año, las grandes ballenas migran hacia el sur para darse un festín de krill en los cortos meses de verano. Pero lo más interesante para mí es lo que sucede cuando regresan al norte hacia las aguas más cálidas. Mientras digieren y excretan sus vientres llenos de comida, las ballenas fertilizan todas las aguas por las que nadan, trayendo nutrientes cruciales de la Antártida a los ecosistemas marinos del mundo. Recién estamos comenzando a desentrañar la compleja red de interconexiones biológicas que nos unen a todos con la Antártida.
Peace through science. Power through science. The power to prepare for the future. That is what makes SCAR so important. There are so many questions we need to answer, so many we have yet to ask.
Como que o aquecimento global está impactando na formação de água profunda na Antártica?
Well, changes in the Southern Ocean result in feedbacks that accelerate the pace of climate change.
O que vai acontecer com os ecossistemas antárticos à medida que o gelo marinho for desaparecendo?
What do we have to do to protect Adélie penguins?
Como que é possível pescar de forma sustentável no Oceano Austral?
Will storms affecting Antarctica become more severe under global warming?
E como que a neve lá na Antártica vai se transformar em chuva?
How will changing wind patterns affect the delicate balance of ice shelves along coastal Antarctica?
Por que as baleias de baixo estão se recuperando da caça industrial, mas as baleias azuis não?
Can we predict when marine ice sheets and ice shelf collapse will be irreversible with severe impacts on global sea level?
A gente pode usar o nosso conhecimento de simulações do Oceano Austral e da Antártica, combinado com dados proxies, para interpretar as projeções do clima no futuro?
Science is our common language, and the global importance of Antarctica demands that we all continue to work together to understand.